Why designers are slow to adopt open source, because most of the people in this room are developers, and you may not realize that not everyone is like you, and most people aren't. So there are some issues. First, we have to take it as a given that designers like using Adobe. They're used to Creative Suite, and they don't really want to change. They're pretty happy with what they have, which is, to my mind, a bit of a problem. So, since they like Adobe, they don't use Floss. Why don't they use Floss? Well, that's basically the bulk of my presentation, why designers don't use Floss. So, why don't we use Floss? There's this great big vicious loop of non-Floss usage in design, and this loop consists of designers are taught Adobe Creative Suite in school. They're employed by companies who believe that Adobe Creative Suite is the industry standard, and they give their output, you know, their print files, to print shops who believe that Adobe Creative Suite is the standard because all of the employers use Adobe Creative Suite, because it's so.
Yeah, just catching on the thing.
Yeah, okay, good. All right, better? So, this is the vicious cycle that we have. Education, employment, and print shops, basically, among other things. Another issue we have is familiarity. Designers are used to Adobe Creative Suite. They, well, as I said, they like it. They, well, anyone who's been educated in the last 15 years or so has been educated largely in Creative Suite, with the exception of the recent transition from Quark to InDesign. But there's this familiarity issue where people like it, they don't want to learn something new, they're willing to do an upgrade from one version to the next, but they're not very interested in learning an entirely new suite of software. So that's a problem. The next is, of course, industry standards. This is one of the biggest bits of the loop. Industry standards, in that basically, files outputted from Adobe Creative Suite programs have become the de facto industry standard. They're not a regulated standard, they're just, well, they're implicit instead of explicit, right? No one has said this will be the standard, as with OpenDocument, for example. They are lovely little de facto standards that exist because everyone's been doing it that way for ages. And again, not interested in change. And my favorite part of the vicious cycle, and the biggest problem, I think, is education. Because in design schools, people are being educated in closed source software. They are not being taught about any alternatives to Creative Suite. They get wonderful deals on Creative Suite. Their schools use it. Their university computer stores sell it to them at a huge discount, so that they get indoctrinated young. Even high schools use it, for goodness sake. If you take a media arts class in a high school, you're taught Photoshop for your photo retouching, and you're taught Illustrator if you do vectors at all. So this is a big problem, because from about the age of, I'd say 16, aspiring designers are learning Adobe Creative Suite. And, well, that doesn't leave much room in their heads for anything else. And of course, employability. Employers who know anything about graphic design use Creative Suite. They buy it because it's the standard. And if you want to be employed, you learn Adobe Creative Suite so that you can find a job. Because if you don't know it, you're not going to meet the brief for most jobs. If you look at design jobs, every job posting will say, knowledge of Photoshop, Illustrator, and InDesign is essential, right? There's very little leeway when it comes to what software packages you're supposed to know in order to be employable as a designer, which is problematic. And also, I know it's a terrible thing to say in this room, but open source does have some serious limitations for professional designers. Having worked in prepress, I've run up against a lot of those problems, because it's lovely for web, right? You can easily do amazing web stuff using only open source software. But as soon as you get to the print process, you start having problems. Because again, not everyone is like the people in this room. If I want to do a CMYK separation on a graphic that's going to go in a newspaper, that's a problem with what currently exists in open source, because the GIMP doesn't have a handy button for it. And I have to go through, you know, something like SK1 in order to... yes, I see your hands. In order to get something suitable for press. So, yes, open source has limitations. And, of course, there are the optics of open source. The people who know about it don't often think too highly of it. They think that it's for geeks. Designers think that it's for amateurs. Because, of course, no, I know it sounds awful, but it's true. Designers look at most designers, not necessarily the lovely people who spoke earlier this morning, but most designers view it as something for amateurs. They say, the industry does not use this. No one teaches this. This is not standard. Only hobbyists use it, right? Geeks use the GIMP to make graphics for their websites, right? To make, you know, cute little penguins. And that's one of the serious problems with the optics of open source. People don't view it, or designers don't view it as a viable option for their professional work. And of course, awareness. I believe the latest number is something like 1% of computer users are using Linux, which is lovely. 1% is great, but that means 99% aren't. And loads of those people don't even know it exists, right? If you ask people if they use any open source software, they won't say that they do, because they don't even know that Firefox is. They just know that it's free. Even if they use it every day, they don't know it. People don't know that open source exists half the time, and if they don't know about it, they can't use it. Problematic. So, all of this raises some questions. Number one, how do we get designers to change their habits? What can we do to convince them that open source A, exists, B, is viable, and C, is something that they can actually see themselves using? Next question, how do we break into the loop? Where do we approach in order to break into the education industry and, in my world, print shop loop, right? Because, of course, if you teach at an educational institution, suddenly all of your graduates are unemployable. If you are a company that wants to use open source, you have to find people who actually know how to use the software. Most people don't. If you're a print shop that wants to transition over to not having a copy of Photoshop, you're going to lose a lot of business. So how do we break the loop? Next, how can designers be encouraged to take ownership? Because this is a very serious problem. Everyone in this room has a certain sense of ownership over their software. You use it, you feel comfortable reporting bugs, you feel comfortable programming and making changes. Most designers don't have a sense of ownership over their software. It's something they use, it's a tool. It doesn't exactly factor into their lives that they can change their software. So designers lack ownership because their ownership is over their design, not over their software. So how do we get that sense of ownership that programmers feel in the open source community and put it into designers? So we have a lovely little case study. It's a student newspaper that I worked for when I was in university, and it has some serious problems because it has a radical mandate and limited means. So theoretically, they would be the perfect office to try open source software in, but they're not because they don't know anything, like most people. So they're running loads of lovely pirated software. They have they're running loads of pirated software. They clone their computers when they get new ones so that they're running two of the same license of Word on two different computers, which means that since it's all networked, when one person opens up Word, someone else's Word crashes, which is not very good for production. It's a weekly newspaper, so during a given production cycle, the fastest, newest computers with their version 4 of Quark that they use for layout crash at least 4 times. Again, problematic, because Quark doesn't do very good backups. So you wind up with a lot of people redoing a lot of work. So one of my goals was to try to get this newspaper to adopt some open source software, because I thought, hey, there are tools for this. They could use Scribus instead of Quark. They could use the GIMP. They could use Inkscape, sorry. Yes, they already use Illustrator. I think there's one computer with 3 different versions of it, actually, because they don't clean up very well. So I thought, wouldn't it be great to get them using something other than Firefox in their office? So we tried to get OpenOffice in. We're still trying to get OpenOffice in, because the editorial staff of this newspaper don't know what OpenOffice is. They've heard of it, but they have no idea what it can do. They are scared of OpenOffice, for goodness sake, because they've said to me, can it export a doc? What kinds of formats does it do? Will we be able to read the stuff that it makes in Quark? Which, of course, to everyone in this room, are kind of absurd questions, because we know that OpenOffice can export just about anything, right? You can do StarOffice files, for goodness sake. Of course, they've never heard of StarOffice, but that's another thing. So this is an issue, because a student newspaper with no money to buy software and a radical mandate and people willing to educate them cannot even bring themselves to try open source software, right? They're stuck on Mac with Creative Suite and Word, and half the time Safari, right? They don't want to change. So how do we deal with everyone else if even these people won't change? So I've devised an action plan, not just for the link, but for everyone, because these are serious issues in design that need to be taken care of, because designers are savvier about computers than the majority of the population, right? They use Mac. They use something other than a browser every day, right? They at least use software other than Internet Explorer and Word on a regular basis. And even they aren't willing to adopt. So what do? We come up with some showpiece software. We say, what can we interest designers in? So this is things like a lot of the projects represented here, right? We show them the GIMP, we show them Inkscape, we show them what actually, well, things that just work, right? Because designers aren't interested in tweaking. Normal people don't want to tweak. They don't want to install a lot of plugins just to do something that they consider basic. They won't do it, right? If your software requires tweaking, they won't touch it, because they don't have the level of engagement that most open source users have. So, pieces of showpiece software that just work. We need to isolate what different professions use, right? So your graphic designer will use, at the moment, the Adobe Creative Suite with Illustrator, Photoshop, InDesign, and potentially Dreamweaver, if they're into web, right? They'll use all of that. So we isolate what they need, we find the open source versions of those, and we create, or at least this is my little baby of an idea, we tailor, in fact, live running CDs that work for each individual group, right? So here is your CD for a graphic designer. Here's your CD for a web designer. It's the same thing, actually. Here's your CD for a product designer, incorporating Blender, you know? All of these amazing programs that exist that aren't on your standard easy live-running Ubuntu disk, for example, right? Because you can plonk Ubuntu in, but it doesn't have everything a product designer needs to get going, right? So here's where the word party comes in, because I know you're all looking at it and saying, party, what's she talking about? We throw Tupperware parties. Right? You take your live running CDs, you take your laptop, you get a group of friends together, you sit them down, and you say, look, Amarok is better than iTunes, right? That's my first thing, because it's amazing how terrible iTunes is, I used it the other day, and I said, oh my goodness, how do you people use this? So we say, this is better than this. The GIMP does what you do with Photoshop, and it works just as well. And you hand them all a disk, and you say, distribute this, rip this, give it to your friends, right? And you get them to at least play with it, because if they never touch it, they'll never know what they're missing. And of course, we need to educate them. And if there are any Montrealers in the audience, you may or may not recognize this building, which is located at 1515 St. Catherine Street. It's the building I went to school in. It's Concordia's Engineering and Visual Arts building, and it suffers greatly from a lack of open source. We need to get open source into schools and get people out of the Adobe box, because in a school where you have something like 5 computer labs on one floor, and all of them are running Creative Suite, you've got a problem, especially since you can't install software on those computers. It's all centralized, right? You need to convince, or rather we need to convince, because I'm not throwing this all out at you, but we need to convince educational institutions to at least realize and recognize that open source software exists and can do, for significantly cheaper, what they're currently doing with things like Creative Suite. We next need to indoctrinate them. I know that sounds like a terrible word, but for goodness sake, they're indoctrinated already into the Adobe cult and the Mac cult. And it's going to take, you know, a little bit of positive brainwashing to get them out, or at least good marketing, which of course is another thing that open source kind of lacks. We don't market ourselves well. So this is what I feel needs to be done in order to get designers interested in open source, get them adopting, get them trying, get them at least realizing that an alternative exists to what they're currently doing. Because let's face it, they're not paying for software anyway. They're pirating Photoshop, we know that. Why not give them some good, proper, free in both senses of the word software, instead of just, you know, running crashy pirated Photoshop? So, question. Actually, we don't want designers to question, I want you to question. Yes.
Yes.
There's another case you have not talked about. All those, I think, designers that use free software, mm-hmm. but don't say it because they're scared. Because when you work with a print shop, for example, and you say, I give you a PDF, but I made you something, don't worry, it will work. You assure that if it don't work, or if there is a little problem, the print shop will say, this is because of the software. And so many people are scared of simply saying that they use the software.
I think that that's tragic. And this is a serious marketing problem. This is the problem with the optics of open source. We have people believing that it's glitchy and bad and somehow worse than the proprietary stuff, which is absurd, because everyone in this room knows that it runs better, it's more reliable, and you get bug fixes way faster, right? So it's really, really, as I said, tragic that designers are lying about their use of open source, and we need to fix that by, you know, giving them a positive view.
So I work for Adobe, and I'm so good. I'm just kidding. I work for the opposite of it. I'm not a designer, but I make my graphics by hand and code in SVG. So I'm not a skilled designer. But sometimes I find the need to do something beyond what I do normally in Inkscape. I've gone into, I have the Creative Suite on my computer, and so I'll sometimes use these ones. They're extremely hard to use. Inkscape is extremely hard to do. Like, if I have a task I want to accomplish, Inkscape is very hard to use. Illustrator, also very hard to use. Photoshop, again, they're all very hard to use. So for people who are picking up, if you just have a simple task, if I wanted to, for example, I wanted to make a transparency on the PNG. And then I opened up the GIMP. I opened up Photoshop. And then I went online, and found a tutorial on how to do it, because there wasn't something, even when I went into their help system, it didn't tell me how to do a very simple task. There are thousands of these tasks that a designer does every day, and they have learned to do them. They've learned to work around the problems in the application that they use. They know how to solve these problems in Photoshop. So for somebody who comes to it, just a hobbyist like myself, it's very difficult because I don't have all that commitment that I put into, all that time I put into learning. It's not just a matter that they like these tools and they work for them. It's that they know how painful it was to learn how to do all these things, and they don't want to give up those skills.
Mm-hmm.
So it's possible that one of the ways to bring people in from Illustrator, from whatever proprietary program, is to have an interface that exactly duplicates what they know how to do. And
which
I know
exists.
What's that?
I believe it may have died by now, but I believe there was a fork of the GIMP that actually replicated the Photoshop interface. GIMP Shop, yeah.
But you can't do it because it's illegal, right? You'll get sued if you do that.
Sure.
So the question is, how can you get, to me, how can you get close enough, or how can you make it easy enough so that when somebody's trying to do something, a task they already know how to do, it's close enough to their workflow that they can actually...
It's...
It's probably not all like this. What's that?
They're talking about professional graphics, I think.
Well, and actually, sorry, that's a really serious problem, because a lot of people already view the GIMP, for example, as a Photoshop clone, which it isn't. The GIMP is not a cheap version of Photoshop, it's something else. So my only worry, I understand what you're saying, because yes, they are hard-fought for skills, but my only worry with that is that the GIMP will lose its GIMPness if it attempts to be Photoshop, right? But,
So I like the idea of a Tupperware party. Maybe a wine and cheese party to get people drunk and bring them to the game. So my question is, so you have this proposal of things like Tupperware party to raise awareness. So have you done this, or do you have plans to actually execute this and see how it goes?
I have plans. I've been spending the last 6 months doing the research on this, trying to figure out exactly what the problems are, because I know it seems obvious that, you know, okay, awareness is a big problem, blah, blah, blah. I've been trying to isolate, you know, all of this that I've just said to you, plus 20 pages more of it. And my next big plan is find the designers, sort out exactly which groups of software, which groups of designers need, because obviously there are very different specializations. Do the live running distros, right? The customized little, you know, industrial designer disk, the graphic designer disk, the web designer disk, and so on. And then, yes, take it to designers. Hassle all of my design friends, you know. Throw them at them if I have to. I've tried it before. Again, I've tried it at the newspaper, and it takes a little bit of hand-holding. So that's the idea behind the Tupperware Party format, the necessary hand-holding to actually get people not just frustrated, but actually interested. So I'm working on it, but yes. Where's the mic?
Sorry, I forgot I had the mic. Damn. So, I mean, a lot of these things proposed, like, are good, but I've tried a few of them, and they haven't worked.
Okay.
One is the live CD. CDs are dead. And like, I put out a CD for Creative Commons called Live Content focusing on these things, and it didn't do that well. Essentially, I wouldn't consider it a failed project of mine, but it was close. But anyway, I think the thing, you know, what is the benefits of getting more people to use this software? Like, what is that about? Like, who cares?
Well,
like, if more people use it.
I personally would hope that, you know, certain people in this room would care about their projects gaining more widespread adoption. Personally, my motivation is political, right? I believe that there's no real it just seems absurd that designers should be so focused on things like, well, on so many social issues, right? There are so many designers working on social issues in proprietary software, and also it frankly hurts that Adobe has such a monopoly, right? That they are the de facto standard, right? There's no competition in this market whatsoever.
I mean, isn't that just because Adobe's been successful at marketing and whatnot?
But
why be mad at Adobe? I'm not trying to belittle the point. I would just propose that, like, you know, we want more people to use the software because we think it'll be better. We want more friends, you know.
Yes.
We want more people to come out of the closet, the whatever, you know, to our Tupperware party, which is usually just a free beer party.
Mm-hmm.
But I'd also argue that it's like, so if more people use it, we'll get better bugs, we'll get things fixed. Okay, that's great and everything, but still, like, what's the point, and how do you get this to happen? We don't have the marketing budget.
Right. You don't need a marketing budget.
It's hard to compete,
mm-hmm,
if that's the goal. I just don't think it's a very valid goal to compete.
Okay.
I think a better goal is to focus upon quality,
right,
and focus on these things. And another thing I'd say is that me, myself, like, I got into Inkscaping things because I maxed out, like, Illustrator and things. And I would argue that most people who use free and open source graphics applications are already masters of the proprietary stuff.
Right.
Or at some point were, can learn it, like, really instantly. So it's a competitive advantage, and this is what Andy Fitzsimon always argues this too. It's like, it's a competitive advantage to know the open source applications because you know the other ones as well, but you also have the added, like, you know, kung fu of scripts and command line and everything like that. So it's an advantage over other people. So, but I would say, you know, how do we get this kind of strategy that's successful, but it's not just spread Firefox? What's the right approach? Is it like more than a Tupperware party? You know, do we really, people want to sit around and talk about software over drinks like that? Other than us here, which we all love to do, we're gonna do it tonight and tomorrow night. Back again to the Blender Institute, this kind of thing. Like, how do you make this sustainable more than just, you know, beer parties and stuff?
Hmm.
How do you make it real?
Well, I mean, if I may say, the whole point of my crusade
I'm
is...
I'm proud of what you're doing.
Oh, yeah. Well, I'm scratching my own itch, right? Because I found myself in pre-press. I found myself by choice using open source software. And I realized that there was nothing easy I could do to actually make my work press ready, right? I had to go through a lot of esoteric things just to get something to press, which really irritated me. I wound up just hopping into Photoshop half the time to do my CMYK separation, right? So that's, in the grand open source tradition, I'm scratching my own itch, right? But.
Or it can be like me, you just know all the bugs, so you just be right around. Just
yeah.
Take a peek.
Okay, I would like to get back to the UI issue and how to get more people to adapt that. Like, guys that over there said, like, well, I find it very hard to pick up any of these programs. That, I'm afraid, is simply intrinsic to the topic we're talking about. This is high-end graphics, and learning these programs is like learning a musical instrument. It needs lots of practice, and there's no way you can get around it. If you want to have an instrument where you can play as a virtuoso, then it's going to be an instrument that's not press three buttons and will play a tune for you. You will have to do it yourself and learn it. So I'm afraid you're simply not in the target user group, and that's it. Now, how to get more people to adopt it, to adopt open free software? It's simply by being better. By being a better product, even if it's totally open and totally free, it's got to be obviously better at doing the job that people have to do. That's focusing on what they want to create, and they get to a level of UI that really adapts to how they think, how they work, and that was where Michael and I are. They are usability and interaction design, because it's not that hard to beat Adobe on those fronts. There's a lot of old crap that they're stuck with and that we don't have to there's two reasons for it. A is, in on all fronts, you spot the obvious mistakes of candidates on the interactive world. They're not going to do that. That destroys my reputation if I would do that. The other point is, if it's just about copying, nobody wants to work on it. It's still a software project, although it's certainly in Jim's case, with really zero money going around it, and it's fully voluntary. But I would say the challenge or the motivation for people is to make something that's good. It's not even to make it their thing, it's to make the best they can. And yeah, with like somebody quoted 2 million functions in Git, I don't think it's that much, but hundreds and hundreds. It is a large dinosaur we're working on, but we're trying to get it in shape to actually compete and to be, from the moment that you pick it up. Once you've got that designer mindset, once you know, we talked about earlier this morning, these generic skills in masking and I don't know what. Once you know that, once you got those skills, it should just be an obviously better fit. It's not all those two.
Okay, there's a lot of people who want to talk. I just can't remember everybody's raising hands all at once, so I'm trying to make it the closest that I can go there around. So just keep in mind that I don't know the names of everybody, and keep it short, please.
Okay, so I'll keep it short. Sorry, I don't want to be too loud. I really like the idea of the Coors Light, the Blender, GIMP, the Scribe, the Party Man, traveling the country. But compared to Tupperware parties, I think there's no incentive like jail time. So if we do care about open source development, I believe all of us should write letters to our elected representative urging them to have the strongest possible anti-piracy laws. So for example, the US should legalize pot, but the mandatory pair plant sentencing guideline should be replaced. You're caught with an illegal copy of Adobe Photoshop 25 years.
You know, the rest of the world, like, software is free. You know, like China, for example. 99% piracy.
That's not free, but software is.
For what most people consider it's free.
I'd like to make a comment or kind of answer a British question about how you may converge or ease the migration between, say, Play Shop and its bunch of menus without making a game shop and without getting sued because you basically cloned their UI. I think one of the reasons, one of the ways to solve this problem is proper documentation in the forms of, social documentation with centralized websites, maybe decentralized might be a good thing, or say users submit their tutorials and convert tutorials what they learn, how you do something in Photoshop and how it translates to the game. And technology has brought us this awesome thing called screencasting and YouTube, and I don't know how they pay their bandwidth deals, but we can use that.
My name is Luke Bones, I work at Intel Technology Center. And basically I work with ThinkScape and Git all day, every day. And a few of my teammates use Adobe Suite all day, every day. And I don't think it really matters what you use, but the problem is compatibility. I can't work with any Illustrator documents, they can't work with my SVG documents. So it really doesn't matter. And the thing is, they try me to convince me using the Adobe stuff. But it's not because they like it or they're used to it. They don't care what I use, but it's the compatibility. That's it.
Not at the UI, but at the file format level. That's where you have to have absolute compatibility.
Sorry. It's going to sound like it's off topic, but it's not. There's a book written by John Cotter. This is a business book, but the name of the book is Leading Change. And I think it's worth reading because you need to read this book to understand why you run into roadblocks when you're trying to change a population of people. It's written from the perspective of somebody running a business trying to get some new programs, and then it turns out the employees come to all the meetings, it's a perfect thing, and then they end up sabotaging it. And you need to understand why that happens and how you create the situation where the employees, or in this case, your users, help you figure out how to get this out there and usable and actually being used. It's a very good book. It's not very big. It's put out, I think, by Harvard Business School. So I think that's worth a lot of people looking at when you're trying to find out what the problem is.
I'm a bit in the same situation as you. I mean, I'm not teaching or something, but I use open source software myself for graphic applications. And some of my friends who are also artistic are interested in what I do and how I do, so they ask me for advice or I get them on the way. But in my experience, even people with a certain interest, just distributing software is not enough. Because, like, if you work, for example, in an architecture office, you learn most of the things, like a program like AutoCAD, you learn it by looking at your colleagues. So I noticed that when I just gave them the software, it mostly doesn't work if they don't find their way around. So the best way, it was when we collaborated in projects and they could learn from me. And another thing was, where software is better, you easily convince. For example, in the Point Factory, they needed to convert a high resolution image just to black and white. And that seemed impossible in Photoshop because it first has to convert to RGB and then back to the pixels. So in the end, they ended up installing GIMP, and now in the Dutch Point Factory, they use GIMP as well.
I also think that it's the right way to just try marketing and promoting stuff, but the key is on quality of open source. So, because if you look at it, Adobe already helps us because they make their users pay quite a high fine of like $1,500 just for using the software. And you don't have to be really better to compete against that. So, and one thing which is probably different also is that what we can offer, what drivers offer us most of the time, is that you can really talk with people who create the software and get your ideas. If you look like the artist before, like Da Vinci or something, yeah? So they either created their own tools or they went to some artisan and told them exactly what they want. And they would get it, yeah. And they would never have put up to going to a shop and having like, okay, I can use this tool, but I can't really change it. And the people who made the tool living on the other side of the earth, and so I can't have contact with them, and so I have no control about the tools. So this is something which only came with industrial age, where all the tools are mass fabricated. And you don't have any possibility to have influence on the kind of tools you have, except for by having market choice, using market choices. And of course, that even that is not possible if there's such a monopoly as with Adobe.
Hi, you mentioned earlier about the sort of the dissonance between designers working on activist issues using proprietary software. Do you think that the different development processes actually produce software that affects the art that you create? Or are the tools more or less the same and it's your own just the language you're using to express yourself?
Well, I think that it's largely just that I believe there's a certain measure of hypocrisy when people are talking about things like, well, civil liberties, freedom of speech, all of these big social issues, and are using locked-in software. It just seems a little bit wrong, but maybe that's just how I see things.
Your radical colleagues simply don't see proprietary software.
We have a mic. If you want to talk, raise your hand. I'll give you a
message. One thing I've done is to change to open source software, free software for side business. So main business, keep it so you know, and have a tool chain of free software where you're not at most production. Work in most cases, and then people get used to free software. That was maybe an idea for standard projects. The other thing so that I'd like to ask is, do you have already something to install a free graphics, new graphics environment or not? You talked about before some pre-configured for with games and stuff. Do you already have it or not?
No, that's my next big project. So I'm not.
And those money pools willing to do it. So.
Really? Okay, because I'm not the techiest person in the room. So.
I just wanted to make this point about copywriting in your interfaces. I mean, there was a big famous lawsuit, Apple versus Microsoft, where Apple tried to sue HP and Microsoft, Right. I mean, there was a whole suite of lawsuits about look and feel, and Apple lost all of them. Lost the appeals, they completely lost. User interfaces are not subject to copyright. And so GIMP shop's totally legal, and no one has to be afraid of copying people's user base if they wanted to. I'm not saying it's a good idea, I'm just saying it's awesome.
Adobe successfully sued.
Adobe successfully sued Macromedia over some of their user interfaces. So this was before they bought them. this was, I'm trying, I'm thinking 99.
Those were widgets though, not menus.
Fair enough. There may be a distinction.
So I guess this is more for the audience in general rather than directly to you. When you were talking about professionals not thinking that open source or free software versions of things are professional tools, nobody in my industry does that. It might be useful to have each project kind of have a very prominent link on the front of their website, listing kind of high profile users of their software. Not only does that help people that come to their site and kind of, oh, right, okay, so this company, that could be used to it, but it also helps us who want to tell them about it. I mean, it's difficult for me to know who uses Scribus in kind of which big companies use it. I have no idea, but if they kind of maintain that list, then I can use it past that.
I've seen lots of colophons, actually. Like the colophon on a book, and they talk about exactly the tools that they used to make their website, and that'd be a really interesting trend if designers certainly sort of.
One thing I think, aside from the general idea of may you copy another program's interface legally, so even before you even get to that point of if you're allowed to, is I think I've seen over the years many times that you really shouldn't try to. If you skin your app to look like another, but it doesn't function exactly like the other application, it's going to only make the users even more frustrated because it looks like Photoshop. Photoshop does things this way, let me do things that way, and it won't quite work. I think one of the classic examples is Emacs. I used Emacs for years and years and years. For me, it's one of the fastest editors around for my work and workflow and typing and all that. But I've seen many, many other editors that try to give you an Emacs mode. The biggest problem is that most of the power of Emacs comes from the Lisp, the functionality, the green buffer, all the internals that these other editors don't have, and they just copy the keyboard layout and hotkeys, which is actually one of the worst things about Emacs. So it's not about can I trick someone into thinking they're running my program, which is why when I got GIMP shop came up, the one camp said, oh, that's the change because that is what stops users from using GIMP. Now that we've removed that, every user is going to switch to it. No, that's not really it, and it turned out not to be the case. If you're driving, a tractor, you want to know you're driving a tractor, you don't want to think that you're sitting in a sports car. You'll have different expectations.
Sorry, I just had a comment back about the sort of social and political issues. I mean, you brought that up sort of at the very end, and it sort of came out in questions that you have a social and political motivation, I think, for using free software. And so I guess what I'm wondering is, why isn't, or shouldn't that be part of your way of trying to market free software to designers? If there are activist designers, why shouldn't that be part of your process of trying to get them to use the software? Because I think, I mean, there are these other considerations of functionality and cost, but I think you've already shown how cost due to piracy isn't an issue. And so if functionality is sort of looking at least getting parity, then you need something more than cost and functionality to motivate people, and maybe political motivation could be part of that.
Well, I totally agree with you on that. And I think I need to do a little bit more market research, because it's a question of isolating the activist designers from all of the designers and figuring out who needs to be using this and why they need to be using it, right? So if it is a case of only activist designers should be using it, then definitely target activist designers. But I'm feeling a little more ambitious than that, you know? I want to see some proper competition, so. And I'm afraid there aren't enough activist designers in the world, even though there are many. They're not the majority, you know, because most designers are kind of, and I don't mean to slander my own industry, but they're kind of, you know, pay me and I'll do what you want type of people, so. Not all of them.
It's okay, most programmers are present.
All right, so I have one more comment. So Creative Commons, like, when it first started, had a difficult time trying to get people to use the licenses. And when I was working for Creative Commons, I worked there for like 3 years, and like, I was like so hell-bent on getting my YouTube to using Creative Commons licenses, like behind the scenes, like working on this for literally 3 years, like stuff you can't talk about it, you know? And like same thing about Facebook, all these different services trying to get them to use it. And none of it worked. Like, I tried activism, I tried these CDs, I tried everything. But one day, like, Trent Reznor decides to use a Creative Commons license just out of the blue. Totally, you know, okay, maybe it was related, maybe not. And I was sitting on a flight going back from Beijing to here, and there's like some like crazy rock band. The guys had like really weird hair. I didn't even ask them their names. It was obvious they're like, you know, like well-off, like rock stars or something. And this guy, like, he was looking, I was trying not to talk to him, he saw, like, my CC stick, and he's like, oh, yeah, is that a thing Trent Reznor started? He was totally wrong, but I was like, whoa, you know, this guy knows because of it. So I would say, you know, pure activism and advocacy is a total waste of time. Is a total money pit, like, it's a distraction, completely. You know, the best thing to get this to work right is to make something great. And if you look at like BitTorrent trackers right now, which are a great way to look at like the reality, you know, the reality of what people use. Like, for example, if you look at BitTorrent, you can see that Prison Break is the most popular show in the whole world. Okay? But it's in ratings, it's not that way. And they even canceled the show. It's like, it doesn't make sense. But if you also look at the video downloads, that's still one of the number one downloads is Elephant's Dream. So if you want to like do this well, and I'm saying this to everyone, then we have to make something great that's not about software. It has to be like the most awesome book or the most awesome movie that's just awesome in its own right. And we have to get large users and adopters. And if we get that, then it just, you get all this other stuff for free, but pure activism doesn't work. It's a money pit. Throw your money, you might as well burn it.
Well, this is a very nice presentation. It's, I think at least you managed to bring up some discussion, which is very nice. And I want to follow up on this activism thing, because, it's
Try to spread the word, even if it's among the convinced people already, because we'll go out and talk about it. And I think one seat at a time might work, you know? It's worth it a try, at least. But I think as an instructor and a graphic designer, I think it's at the school level that you have to start spreading this. And you have to go to a primary school in Quebec and say, hey, yeah, I have a bunch of free time this weekend. I'll come and I'll give you a workshop for this 7-year-old people. And it's like your first bank account. You're stuck to Royal Bank if you open your bank account there. And that'll be a bit like that, that if you get your first skills using GIMP or Scribe, and then you feel comfortable and you feel that you can say, well, why use this other thing? You know, I'm fine like this, I don't need to change. So it's starting with people that don't know CS3 yet. Not my kids, unfortunately. They're waiting for me to go. But I think it's awesome. It's great.
Sorry, I'm frozen. just to push a bit, I have exactly the same reaction, and I think activism is maybe a stronger word. It's not the word, but with my students, they have 20, they use CS3 for 3 to 4 weeks, years, and when I say, you know, you are not obliged to use pirated software, the first time I say that, they don't listen. The second time, one of them, yes, what? And then I show other stuff, and then I show even the reduction for the price on to that they buy Adobe stuff. Can I explain a bit? And at the third time, it's really a kind of, oh, we always think about that from the secondary school. We always at school use pirated software word. We see teachers doing that. My father is earning money by co-buying DVDs and this kind of stuff. And it's really, when you do the switch, they really switch. And so it's not, is it activism? I don't know. It's a kind of, but it's simply, how do you name that? Citizenship or something like that. Sorry to came with use stuff like that, but I think if yes, the education begins from the start. I have two daughters, and there is discussion between me and them on Facebook, MSN, this kind of stuff. All of you have this kind of discussion, I mean, it can really work, I think.
Okay, that's the last thing. But I want to say, as an instructor, I think the strategy would be to start with a little project that you start and finish that day. You know, let's do your business card using GIMP and Scribe. So then they feel like, wow, I can actually accomplish something with this. So starting small, I think it's a good thing.
I'm coming to you. So just want to mention that when I first talked to Ginger, I knew this would happen. I knew. I knew from the start that this would be a very good discussion. I want to say just one thing. I'm in the graphic art industry. I do a few. I not teach, but I go and give some workshops in the schools and things like that. And I think yes, it's a very good place to start. I think we also need here, at least, because I know in Europe it's pretty different, but here we need some strong support from the political world, which we don't get really. There is no intentions towards the adoption of free software here. So we need that to happen too. So anyway, so yes, it starts in the schools.
Someone else?
And I know we're deeply into the lunch time now, so I don't want to refrain this discussion. If anybody wants to talk, we can continue. I will hand on the mic to you over there. After, please raise your hands, and also if you feel that it's okay, we're going to make that maybe a short, maybe 5 minutes, a few interventions, and then we go off to lunch. Is that okay?
I think it's not true to say that activism doesn't work. I think it's just that quite often activism is very slow. It's kind of one person to one person. And I think that's what you were basically saying.
I'm saying it's like a band that tries to get a music label.
Yeah.
You know, you're better off working at the same level.
I'll hand the mic back over to you. I think it's just about being smarter about activism. Not go home and don't try and spread the word. It's kind of... Yeah, you can, and I'm sure whoever the rock star was, someone told them about it, or someone put some information on the website that they're going to use Creative Commons license.
It's a waste of time to be here.
I think the trend resident thing actually disproves your point
because really, that's actually an example of how activism works. It begins low level. Interest builds, and then it finds a spokesman. And I'm sure Trent Reznor didn't just, you know, wander around the internet one day and find Creative Commons. He probably heard of it, you know, word of mouth from someone, and then he becomes a spokesman for it, and people gain interest. So I think that's actually an example of how activism works, not how it doesn't.
You know, kudos to you. I mean, good presentations usually mean that people talk between themselves and you don't have to do anything. So I would say that by pure activism, I mean hand waving. So what does work is creating good projects. And Creative Commons is a slow, you know, standing on the shoulders, you know, kind of growing back and forth. So what I would say is a constructive step from this discussion is to select a project. To select something that's doable and is concrete and is not necessarily about free software and our projects. That's a good thing, you know, maybe a book, maybe something like that that's concrete, that takes it to the next level, but it involves all our different projects. That to me is doable. And is something that can build, like maybe every year we do LGM, we put out a book, you know, that is released and involves students and involves people. And that's why Creative Commons is successful. I heard one guy, this guy who wears Magnitude, sing this to musicians. It's like, you know, you can't just get a music label contract. That's stupid. It's very unlikely. But what you can do is work with people at the same level and raise the level of water at the same time. But it doesn't work as well to just jump to this level like that, you know, really high scale. But that's why I think, you know, Blender, you know, and I think Project Peach and open source game is great. Maybe we make an open source game. Maybe we participate more in that, and that gets a lot of press, and that then generates more users, and generates more people. That sounds weird. Anyway, yeah, the other one.
I think making workshop with children. To show them how it works, it's a good idea, but it will take 20 years before they became themselves graphic designer. So the question was, how make now graphic designer use free software? And of course, we have to show how good they are to create. But the trouble is that, the major trouble is that when a graphic designer wants to know how GIMP is working, or how Inkscape or Scribus or any other software is working, he just don't find anyone at his level to have an answer. So when a graphic designer asks the local Unix user group, doesn't find any graphic designer here, so anyone who is able to answer this question, how can I use mask in GIMP, for example? So the problem is, as on one hand you have a graphic designer, and on the other hand you just have a user, which is not really the same.
Well, actually that's the joy of open source though, because it actually generates community, right? If I want to find out, granted Adobe has the creative or the critical mass, so if I want to find something out, it's pretty easy to find. But I believe someone mentioned earlier that the joy of open source is you can actually talk to the developers about it, who know better than anyone else exactly how it works, even though they're not designers. And trust me, being a designer sitting in this room, I know how it feels to be a designer among developers, but that's something that, you know, it's chicken and egg, right? Because we need to figure out how to get designers in so that there will be designers for other designers to talk to. It's the loop again, so.
So, I'm saying graphic designer to use how to program. So, how now would we programmer how to become graphic designer and show themselves?
Wait, how to get programmers to become graphic designers? Well, a lot of you in this room probably do some of that already, because the gentleman back there from the W3C was talking about trying to learn the GIMP, right? Trying to figure out how to make a transparent PNG, right? So already we have people from less designy sectors getting into design. I mean, it's a symptom of today, right? Everyone and their dog knows how to use Photoshop. We just need to get everyone and their dog to go for the GIMP instead, including and especially developers, but who knows how.
I think the best way to get people to convert is by giving them a good choice. And a good choice doesn't only start at quality software. It has to go into also interoperability, like when the guys there were talking about. If you can get people to integrate your tools in the pipeline, not only by completely switching to your tool, but getting your tool integrated seamlessly into their pipeline, then it's easier to get people to switch. Like a great example of one thing that happened in the Blender community and the Blender software is when we integrated some research done in UVM wrapping. Because of our, some of our good import-export feature, some studios started integrating that for unwrapping the model. And they don't even have to use software like more than 5 minutes, but if you can sneak in a little bit, then you can sneak in and sneak in and sneak in, and eventually they're using it, and then they report bugs, and you're getting there. You don't enter a market by stumping in and do like, we want you to use our software. You get there by giving them good incentive to use it. Like, that means good features, and that means interoperability and good ways for them to integrate without losing their frameworks and their pipeline. Well, maybe one last word. A good way to do that is by having video tutorials, because then people can just show what can be done. And something like a book or a text tutorial is not good for that, because you have to read it and you have to be attentive and you have to pay attention. Whereas for video tutorials or just video session, you can just broadcast it and people can just look at it and be like, it's more flashier and more easier to see what's being done.
Okay, so we're going to take one last.
I come from a totally different area. I'm a mechanical engineer. And I'm surprised we had discussions of identity a few years ago. So if I could just throw in one item that's happening to our software industry. The tools that we use are simulation tools, some large amount of equations to simulate cars, airplanes, something like this. And you have several editors and other functionality. But side, they use that piece of software kind of by themselves, beginning to provide the open source code. I mean, parts of it. So if you make that their software, it's a huge building. And the way the open source community is entered is into the bricks. And that's probably where individuals, such as ourselves, can best be more efficient. You know, we can write TX or whatever, but individuals can write in the Unix fashion bricks, good bricks. You know, you write a piece of software that does one thing, does it well, with good communication about bricks.
So my very quick comment is about the video tutorials. And I don't know how many people are aware, but Firefox is shipping all Fiora support. And it's coming back to your tutorials, your video tutorials point. I just wanted to say that Firefox is shipping all Fiora support, native support in like about 2 months whenever we ship. So we have very fast uptake, so within kind of 6 months, 90% of our users will usually be in the next version. So hopefully we need some really, really simple screencasting software to create all of Fiora. That'd be really cool. So someone's try that.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.